For years, NVIDIA's GeForce 70 class GPUs have been the sort of go-to cards for high-end gamers looking to not sell their soul for a high-end card. With the launch of the RTX 4070, I wanted to take a look at the evolution of the 70 class to see how those cards have evolved over the years, starting with the GTX 1070. Is the 70 series still a sweet spot for 1440p? Can the RTX 4070 series comfortably hit 4K now? How has pricing evolved? All of that and more will be answered in this video, so let's get to it. NVIDIA's 70 class has historically done very well in delivering a top-tier experience for 1440p and high-refresh rate 1080p gaming, but it hasn't exactly been the cheap line since the introduction of the GTX 970 way back in 2014. Since then, the hardware demand from games has risen exponentially in many cases, especially within the past year. But demand on the hardware isn't the only thing that has gone up. So have the prices, especially during the dark days of the pandemic and mining boom. In order to look back at a historical trend, I fired up four generations of 70 class cards, starting with the GTX 1070, which launched 7 years ago. All of the cards I tested were Founders Edition model, except for the new RTX 4070. The version I had on hand for the launch was a Zotac model, so unfortunately it doesn't match the others, but it's what I had available to me, and performance isn't too far off from the Founders Edition. Now, if you want a full written review of the Founders Edition RTX 4070, then head over to PC World and check out what Brad Charkas had to say about it. But before you do that, please attack that subscribe button on YouTube to see more PC hardware testing videos. And before we get to the results, I want to take a quick look at the Zotac Gaming GeForce RTX 4070 Amp Aero I'm using for testing. It features 5,888 CUDA cores running at just over 2700 MHz and 12 gigs of GDDR6X VRAM at an effective rate of 21 gigabits per second. This beefy model of the RTX 4070 features a massive 2.5 slot Ice Storm 2.0 cooler that absolutely delivers on cooling and noise. Now, I'd love to tell you how quiet it is, but I couldn't get a good reading since the Arctic Cooling 420mm AIO on my test bench made more noise than the card itself. As expected, with such a massive cooler, thermals were pretty good, topping out at 65°C after an hour of looping time spy. Of course, the RTX 40 series also brings cool new features to the table like DLSS 3 and AV1 encoding. However, keep in mind that the RTX 4070 is the first 40 series card to only feature a single AV1 encoder, though. And I'll touch on DLSS 3 performance and how it's needed in Cyberpunk 2077's new RT Overdrive mode. But most of my testing was done without it. With the limited time I had, I chose to focus on 1440p and 4K performance to see just how far the 40 series has come at pushing more pixels. Okay, so into the gaming performance. As we go through the titles I selected here, you'll notice I tested more than just the latest games. I wanted to showcase a game or two from each card's heyday, which I thought would be a fun way to look at all things. And I'm starting with GTA 5. Not only was this a big title when the GTX 1070 came out, it's still a most played title according to Steam. I can see healthy gains across generations, but diminishing returns on the latest cards in average FPS. The same story can be told at 4K, but truthfully, these cards are tuned and geared more towards modern API, so seeing any kind of uplift here was nice. Hitman 2016 is another title from the GTX 1070 era and was in the early days of DX12. Despite that, we can see a pretty clear performance uplift from generation to generation, with 1% lows almost matching the next older card's average performance. Solid 4K performance with these settings is really only obtainable once you get to the RTX 2070, which was about half the performance of the new RTX 4070. Horizon Zero Dawn showcases a similar performance delta between each generation, but 4K just isn't where any of these cards shine. At 1440p, the RTX 2070 does break that 60fps barrier though, and the 4070 hits double that again. It's one rare example in my testing where the RTX 4070 is double the performance of the 2070. An interesting sight to see as that card is 5 years old now. Forza Horizon 4 was and still is a fan favorite, and it launched around the same time as the RTX 2070. This game was also a real showcase for next-gen graphics at the time, and there is a nice scaling in performance from card to card. Driving games benefit from smooth gameplay, which is represented by tight 1% lows, and each card does, well, pretty well here. While Far Cry 5 is optimized for Radeon, it was still a showcase game for all PC gamers when it came out. First-person shooters are perfect use cases for high refresh rate 1440p gaming, but 120 FPS isn't achieved on cards older than the RTX 3070. Either way, we are continuing to see a similar performance curve when comparing generations across all metrics. The RTX 3070 came out a bit before Cyberpunk 2077, which was a huge showcase around that launch. With these settings, none of the 70 series cards can achieve a solid 4K performance without some sort of upscaling tech. The RTX 4070 and 3070 can hit 60 FPS or more at 1440p though, but I'll be covering DLSS performance later just to see how high the 4070 can reach. The next two games are recent releases, and Modern Warfare 2 is still extremely competitive with many people playing daily. The 1% lows for each card are some of the worst I've seen, and even with the RTX 4070, it struggles at both resolutions. Also interesting is that the performance jump from generation to generation isn't as linear as past games have been. Returnal is the newest game on the list and a tough one to run, not just because of high VRAM requirements. Case in point, the RTX 4070 is the only card to hit over 60 FPS average at 4K, but the 3070 can hit that at 1440p. Either way, you're seeing similar performance curves from generation to generation, despite the lower performance numbers. At these settings, we're not seeing a clear problem with VRAM when comparing card to card. It's scaling seemingly appropriate. Last but not least is CS:GO. It's the oldest title on the list, and it presents an interesting picture. At both resolutions, I'm hitting the limits of the test bench here, which feature a Ryzen 9 5900X at the heart of it. With this hardware, we're not seeing any performance improvements from the 3070 to the 4070 across both resolutions, and I wanted to show this CPU bottleneck because it's a good reminder that you can't always brute force performance with a new GPU. Now look, raster performance is one thing, but NVIDIA's move from the GTX to the RTX line saw new features introduced like ray tracing support and DLSS. In order to test those features, I'm using Cyberpunk 2077, which brings most GPUs to their knees with ray tracing turned on. Here I'm using the Ultra preset and setting DLSS to the quality setting. We can see a clear improvement when going from the RTX 2070 to the 3070. But it's the 4070 that finally hits 60 FPS on average. Sorry, GTX 1070. Even though you were given the ability to output ray tracing, the developers kind of locked you out of this one. Speaking of locked, DLSS 3 frame generation is only available for the RTX 4070, and enabling that doubles what the RTX 3070 could output, but without any drop in latency. Hybrid ray tracing like this is one thing, but the new Cyberpunk 2077 RT Overdrive mode that just came out cranks things to 11 by adding path tracing to the entire game. Right here, we see a very clear 50% performance boost generationally when using these settings, which do include DLSS balance settings. The game goes from unplayable on the RTX 2070 to a smooth console 30 on the 3070. But the 4070 still can't crack an average 60 FPS unless you use DLSS 3. Even before that, there's still an easy to follow 50% boost each gen, but more than double if you're good with using DLSS 3. And honestly, all of the talk from CD Projekt Red and NVIDIA before the launch of this had us worried that the only card that was going to do this would be the 4090. So the fact that the 4070 can technically get there is surprising. So overall, the generational performance uplift is pretty solid between these four GPUs. But it's time to talk about the elephant in the room, the price. While this specific Zotac RTX 4070 model clocks in at $670, overall performance isn't going to be much different than it would be with the Founders Edition. But since the GTX 1070, the 70 class card's pricing has been a roller coaster of a ride and is often remembered through rose-colored lenses. The GTX 1070 Founders Edition was released in 2016 with an MSRP of $449. Admittedly, you could get an AIB model for as low as $380, but we all remember how well that went, didn't we? The RTX 2070 Founders Edition, released in 2018, ushered in the RTX branding and came with an unwelcome price hike to $600. It's understandable why people were angry about this, as it was an example of price increases almost one-to-one with the traditional rasterization performance increase. NVIDIA's argument at the time was that it was adding in all of the extras that made it an RTX card rather than a GTX card. But that didn't quite convince the people who didn't care about those features to begin with. In 2020, we were greeted with the RTX 3070 Founders Edition, which had a price reduction in addition to performance increase. The price got closer to the GTX 1070, on paper at least, coming in at $500, but of course we were in the midst of many global problems and that price was mainly a pipe dream. And here we are with the RTX 4070 coming to market at a starting point of $600, back to where it was with the 2070. Admittedly, it's more than most would have wanted, but at least this time we're finally seeing NVIDIA give customers more than 8GB of VRAM at the 70 class. So to sum it up, the RTX 4070 in raw numbers delivers at least 20% or better performance over last generation, and it's costing, well, about 20% more. It's giving more VRAM as well as delivering on new features like DLSS3 and AV1 encoding. So there are benefits to the RTX 4070, but there isn't much to get excited about either, especially if you were looking for a huge raster uplift. While this launch is unlikely to genuinely spark excitement in most people, it's a solid offering and the price is somewhat reasonable for the performance that is delivered. At the end of the day, if you aren't happy or excited about the RTX 4070, well, vote with your wallets, people, and look at other options. Either way, I'd love to hear what you have to say about the RTX 4070 and, more specifically, this Zotac Gaming RTX 4070 Amp Aero model down in the comments section. While you're down there, make sure you hit the subscribe and the bell notification so that you don't miss out on even more hardware and software goodness.